but I will not have her mended, and her figurehead, a gallant warrior in a cocked hat, lies pitching head foremost down in the trough of a calamitous sea under the bows. But I will not have him put on his legs again till I get on my own, for between him and me there is a secret sympathy. And my sisters tell me, even yet, that he fell from his perch the very day I left home to go to sea on this my first voyage. Chapter 2. Redburn's Departure from Home. It was with a heavy heart and full eyes that my poor mother parted with me. Perhaps she thought me an erring and a willful boy, and perhaps I was, but if I was, it had been a hard-hearted world, and hard times that had made me so. I had learned to think much and bitterly before my time. All my young mounting dreams of glory had left me, and at that early age I was as unambitious as a man of 60. Yes, I will go to sea, cut my kind uncles and aunts and sympathizing patrons, and leave no heavy hearts but those in my own home, and take none along but the one which aches in my bosom. Cold, bitter, cold as December, and bleak as it blasts, seemed the world then to me. There is no misanthrope like a boy disappointed, and such was I, with the warmth of me flogged out by adversity. But these thoughts are bitter enough even now, for they have not yet gone quite away, and they must be uncongenial enough to the reader. So no more of that, and let me go on with my story. "Yes, I will write you, dear mother, as soon as I can," murmured I, as she charged me for the 100th time not fail to inform her of my safe arrival in New York. "And now, Mary, Martha, and Jane, kiss me all round, dear sisters, and then I am off.